are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon. Welcome back to Theater 100, Television, Film, and Theater. My name is Naomi Buckley, and I'm the instructor for this course. And we are in our eighth broadcast today. And I want to welcome you back. Hopefully, many of you tuned in on Saturday or were here on campus on Saturday to see Cabaret. I hope that you enjoyed that performance that did open this last weekend. And if you didn't get a chance to see it in person and you live locally, I want to encourage you to come out this Friday or Saturday at 8 p.m. Saturday will be the last show. And if you do come and see it in person, you can definitely use that for your live performance theater. That you need to write a little paper about for a show that you see in person. So today we're going to be talking about chapters 7 and 8 on playwriting. The beginning, before we start talking about that, we're going to spend some time talking about Elizabethan theater and Shakespeare, which is one of my more favorite things to talk about. So we'll spend some time talking about that. And of course, I want to remind you that we are live and online. You can always give us a call at 1-800-339-1193. Or you can type in your comments or questions to ask.dhtv@gmail.com. And there it is at the bottom of the screen. So I want to start today by asking you a little question that you can type in and respond to, or you can give us a call and respond to that way. And it is, if any of you are familiar with this time period, how was the acting style in Shakespeare's time different from ours today? There are definitely some differences between the acting style that was prevalent in Shakespeare's time and the type of acting that we consider good or quality today. So I'd be interested in hearing many of you comment on what you might know about that. So again, you can feel free to call us, 1-800-339-1193, or send your comments to us online at askdhtv@gmail.com. All right, so let's spend a little bit of time talking about Elizabethan theater. We're going to start by talking about just kind of generally the time period, and then we're going to get a little more deeply into Shakespeare himself and the plays that he wrote. We've got some wonderful clips to watch today that are from some of his more well-known pieces. So theater of the Elizabethan times, which is when Shakespeare was writing, reflected the impact that capitalism and exploration had had on the English Empire. Of course, after the English defeated the Spanish Armada in 1588, the empire itself greatly expanded and became much more wealthy and prosperous and became much more of a power in the Elizabethan world, a political power as well as an economic power. And their control of the seas let them explore and colonize the New World. Of course, we all know about that, right? And this was after the Spanish had already established many colonies in the New World, but they also started establishing colonies and growing crops and over there that were shipped to England. Tea crops and tobacco crops were some of the two major crops that were grown by the English in the New World, as well as potatoes and other vegetables that were grown and then shipped back over to the motherland of England. And they began to move away from the church. As we know, when Henry VIII decided to divorce his wife, and the church was not for that, they broke away from the church and started the Anglican Church, which the king, that being Henry VIII at the time, was the head of. And they really broke away also from Catholicism. But when Elizabeth came into power, there was a return not necessarily to Catholicism, because she wasn't a Catholic, but to Protestantism and definitely secularization as well. So the plays at the time also reflected that. They reflected heroes and conquests and also the Shakespearean histories, which were some of the first plays that he wrote, reflected this kind of nationalism and appreciation for secular things as well as the authority of the hierarchy that was existent during the time. So we're going to take a little look at one of Shakespeare's histories, which is one of the first of a tetralogy, which starts with Richard II and then ends with one of the Henrys. And this is a little clip from one of Shakespeare's more well-known histories, Richard II.
Thank you both. Yet one but flatters us, as well appeareth by the cause you come, namely to appeal each other of high treason. Cousin of Hereford, what dost thou object against the Duke of Norfolk, Thomas Mowbray?
First heaven be the record to my speech. In the devotion of a subject's love, tendering the precious safety of my prince. Now, Thomas Mowbray, do I turn to thee, and mark my greeting well. For what I speak, my body shall make good upon this earth, or my divine soul answer it in heaven. Thou art a traitor and a miscreant, too good to be so, and too bad to live. Since the more fair and crystal is the sky, the uglier seem the clouds that in it fly. Once more, the more to aggravate the note, with a foul traitor's name stuff I thy throat, and wish, so please my sovereign, ere I move, what my tongue speaks, my right drawn sword may prove.
Let not my cold words here accuse my zeal. 'Tis not the trial of a woman's war. The bitter clamor of two eager tongues can arbitrate this cause betwixt us twain. The blood is hot that must be cooled for this. Yet can I not of such tame patience boast as to be hushed and naught at all to say. First, the fair reverence of your highness curbs me from giving reins and spurs to my free speech, which else would post until it had returned these terms of treason doubled down his throat. Setting aside his high blood's royalty, and let him be no kinsman to my liege, I do defy him, and I spit at him, call him a slanderous coward and a villain, which to maintain I would allow him odds and meet him were I tied to run afoot, even to the frozen ridges of the Alps, or any other ground inhabitable wherever Englishman durst set his foot. Meantime, let this defend my loyalty. By all my hopes, most falsely doth he lie.
Pale, trembling coward, there I throw my gage, disclaiming here the kindred of the king, and lay aside my high blood's royalty, which fear, not reverence, makes thee to accept. If guilty dread have left thee so much strength as to take up mine honor's pawn, then stoop. By that, and all the rights of knighthood else, will I make good against thee, arm to arm, what I have spoke, or thou canst worse devise.
I take it up, and by that sword I swear, which gently laid my knighthood on my shoulder, I'll answer thee in any fair degree or chivalrous design of knightly trial. And when I mount, alive may I not light if I be traitor or unjustly fight.
What doth our cousin lay to Mowbray's charge? It must be great that can inherit us so much as of a thought of ill in him. Look, what I speak, my life shall prove it true, that Mowbray hath received 8,000 nobles in name of lendings for your highness' soldiers, the which he hath detained for lewd employments, like a false traitor and injurious villain. Besides, I say, and will in battle prove, or here, or elsewhere, to the furthest verge that ever was surveyed by English eye, that all the treasons for these 18 years complotted and contrived in this land fetch from false Mowbray their first head and spring. Further, I say, and further will maintain upon his bad life to make all this good, that he did plot the Duke of Gloucester's death, suggest his soon believing adversaries, and consequently, like a traitor coward, sluiced out his innocent soul with streams of blood, which blood, like sacrificing Abel's, cries even from the tongueless caverns of the earth to me for justice and rough chastisement. And by the glorious worth of my descent, this arm shall do it, or this life be spent.
How high a pitch his resolution soars. Thomas of Norfolk, what sayst thou to this?
Oh, let my sovereign turn away his face, and let his ears a little while be deaf, till I have told this slander of his blood how God and good men hate so foul a liar.
Mowbray, Impartial are our eyes and ears. Were he my brother, nay, my kingdom's heir, as he is but my father's brother's son, now by my scepter's oar I make a vow. Such neighbor nearness to our sacred blood should nothing privilege him, nor partialize the unstooping firmness of my upright soul. He is our subject, Mowbray. So art thou. Free speech and fearless I to thee allow.
Then, Bolingbroke, as low as to thy heart through the false passage of thy throat thou liest. Three parts of that receipt I had for Calais dispersed I duly to his highness soldiers. The other part reserved I by consent, for that my sovereign liege was in my debt upon remainder of a dear account since last I went to France to fetch his queen. Now swallow down that lie. For Gloucester's death, I slew him not. But to my own disgrace, neglected my sworn duty in that case. For you, my noble lord of Lancaster, the honorable father to my foe, once did I lay an ambush for your life, a trespass that doth vex my grieved soul. But ere I last received the sacrament, I did confess it and exactly begged your grace's pardon. And I hope I had it. This is my fault. As for the rest appeal, it issues from the rancor of a villain, a recreant and most degenerate traitor, which in myself I boldly will defend and interchangeably hurl down my gage upon this overweening traitor's foot to prove myself a loyal gentleman even in the best blood chambered in his bosom. In haste whereof, most heartily I pray your highness to assign our trial day.
Wrath kindle, gentlemen, be ruled by me. Let's purge this collar without letting blood. This we prescribe, though no physician. Deep malice makes too deep incision. Forget, forgive. Conclude and be agreed, our doctors say this is no month to bleed. Good uncle, let this end where it begun. We'll calm the Duke of Norfolk, you, your son.
Be a make peace shall become my age. Throw down, my son, the Duke of Norfolk's gage.
And Norfolk throw down his.
When, Harry, when? Obedience bids I should not bid again.
Norfolk, throw down. We bid, there is no boot.
Myself, I throw dread sovereign at thy foot. My life thou shalt command, but not my shame. The one my duty owes, but my fair name, despite of death that lives upon my grave, to dark dishonors use thou shalt not have. I am disgraced, impeached, and baffled here, pierced to the soul with slander's venomed spear, the which no balm can cure but his heart blood, which breathed this poison.
Rage must be withstood. Give me his gage. Lions make leopards tame.
Yea, but not change his spots. Take but my shame, and I resign my gage. My dear, dear lord, the purest treasure mortal times afford is spotless reputation. That away men are but gilded loam or painted clay. A duel in a 10 times barred up chest is a bold spirit in a loyal breast. Mine honor is my life, both grow in one. Take honor from me, and my life is done. And here, my liege, mine honor, let me try. In that I live, and for that will I die.
Cousin, throw up your gage. Do you begin?
Oh, God, defend my soul from such deep sin. Shall I seem crestfallen in my father's sight? Or with pale beggar fear impeach my height before this outdared dastard? Ere my tongue shall wound my honor with such feeble wrong, or sound so base a parle, my teeth shall tear the slavish motive of recanting fear, and spit it, bleeding in his high disgrace, where shame doth harbor, even in Mowbray's face.
We were not born to sue, but to command. Since which we cannot do to make you friends, be ready, as your lives shall answer it, at Coventry upon St. Lambert's Day. There shall your swords and lances arbitrate the swelling difference of your settled hate. Since we cannot atone you, we shall see justice design the victor's chivalry. Lord Marshal, command on officers at arms. Be ready to direct these home alarms.
So that was a long clip, but it was wonderful, wasn't it? And again, that's from Richard II, the beginning of a set of four plays that begin with that one and then end with one of the Henrys. And it's a history play that tracks kind of the monarchy over the course of changing hands throughout the English history. And Richard II is actually overthrown and then eventually killed. It's kind of a play that's a little close to my heart because there is a piece from that, a monologue that I used for my audition for my master's degree. I did a monologue playing Anne, who is in the play, is Richard II's wife. So very close to my heart. All right. So as you can see, Shakespeare's tragedies dealt with the kind of issues of the monarchy and those in the aristocracy, and was a way to kind of retell these stories. Of course, the aristocracy at the time was also sort of had celebrity status. It was always very interesting, and lots of gossip always flying around about them. So these were very interesting stories that went around, and people were interested in hearing. They were interested in looking into the lives of these kind of classic heroes that came from their past. And it was based, though, to a certain extent, on actual historical documents. And Shakespeare did sort of look back into historical documents to use them, although there was also some liberties taken in the writing. All right, at the time that these things were being written, you know, in the Elizabethan area, as Shakespeare was writing these plays, London was teeming with business activity. There was a lot of businesses that existed in London proper, and it was difficult to get to a play, not only because of timing issues, but also because people were busy, and it was a very crowded, for those of you who've ever been to London, London proper at the time only existed. It's hard to describe it, but if you've ever been there, London is divided through concentric circles, and it's kind of through the use of the tube system. There's from a zero all the way to seven, and London proper really only existed in the zero, the very, very central, most heartmost center that is now still there in London, but now London also, the metropolis, also includes a wide variety of other neighborhoods and areas that extend out of there. But it was very kind of compact, very busy, very, very business-centered metropolis, and it was difficult to get to go to see a play. And also because the Puritans controlled the city center. So there was a lot of opposition to the theater, and so theater was forced outside of London. And the Puritans basically hated the excess. They didn't believe it was a moral thing to engage in these theatrical entertainments. It wasn't moral for people to go and watch them. You know, keep in mind, people that went to go and see these things often, you know, drank beer while they were watching the play, and they ate, and they were kind of bawdy and loud. So it was viewed as kind of a not very moral activity to engage in. Therefore, a lot of the theater houses were pushed outside of the central area of London, out into Bankside, which now is part of London, but at the time wasn't. It wasn't part of London proper. And this required you to actually cross a bridge in order to get to the other side of the River Thames to go to see these theaters. And alongside these theaters existed a wide variety of other entertainments that the Puritans also considered immoral, such as bear baiting rings, gambling, prostitution houses, and a wide variety of other things that existed on the outside of London proper. But they weren't, they didn't have to adhere to the same laws as the other businesses and places that existed inside of the city. So, but in 1642, that was when the Protestants took over. They did succeed in closing down most of the theaters that were inside of London and pushing them out into the outside of London, into Bankside. So we're going to take a little look now at the kind of what the physical workings of what an Elizabethan theater looked like. And the best example that we have to date is a sketch by DeWitt, which is of the Swan. And the Swan was one of the contemporaries with the Globe. And actually, if we could take this into a full screen so we can get a better look at it, and I'll maybe point some things out to you here. One of the things that you notice is that it is theater in the round. You're just looking at a portion here of the theater. But that circular seating area, which is marked here and here, goes all the way around. This area here is where the standing room only was for the groundlings, and those were the penny seats that people come and see. And in these boxes here, these were the more expensive seats, and oftentimes where these arrows are here and here, that's where the aristocracy used to sit, or sometimes even on the stage. You can see we have kind of a thrust stage that comes out into the house, and we have this roof that goes over. Here in this upper area, that's where the musicians would be, and also where certain special effects or sound effects would come from. They could also lower actors down from this heavens area down onto the playing space. And there was actually also often trap doors in the stage that could take actors down or up. I'm gonna erase that and just show you something else here. Wait, it's not erasing. Okay, well, anyways, you see that the stage comes out and thrusts into the area. Behind that as well is a two-tiered area behind that, on that staged area, where there are a variety of entrances, doors, and openings, usually three. A balcony area up on top, and then kind of two or three entrances on the bottom. And this was kind of standard. We believe that the globe was very, very similar to this. The Swan, of course, was a competing theater that existed at the time, but the theaters were basically very similar in construction, and we have very few documents that tell us. We have one document that actually describes the theater to us, but we don't actually have any sketches except the one that you just saw, which was from DeWitt, and that, again, was of the Swan, not of the globe. The globe actually burned down a couple times in its life and was rebuilt. The first time it burnt down because of some cannon fire that was used in one of the Henry plays, that they used actual cannons. And you might have noticed, you can kind of see it in this picture, that all the theaters had thatch roofs. And this is kind of a straw-like roof that's very dry and obviously could catch fire very easily. The cannon fire shot out, caught the roof on fire, and then the whole entire building burned down because it's built of wood. They did then rebuild the theater in relatively the same place, not the exact same place. And but again, we still don't have that theater also burnt down and then was not rebuilt. But we don't have any real drawings of the globe, but we do know that it was probably very similar from description to the Swan and to various other theaters that were there at the same time. As I mentioned, in those gallery spaces and those kind of tiered gallery spaces, that's where a lot of the closer to the stage, that's where the aristocracy sat. Further out, that's where a lot of the middle class people, the people that had more money, this emerging middle class that was coming out, the merchant class would sit. And those people that were in the working classes, the poorer people, could get the penny groundling area, and they would pay a penny and they could come in and stand as closely packed as they could into that area that was right in front of the stage, but it was standing only. I did live in London for a few years, and so I was privileged enough to be able to go and see a couple, more than a couple, but some performances in the new Old Globe, which stands still on Bankside, not in the exact same place, but maybe a half a mile from where the original Old Globe stood. And I did stand in the groundling area as well as the upper area. If you ever get there, what's really interesting, and one of the things I found fascinating, is that as I was standing in the groundling area, it's a fair size, but it actually holds much less people today than the original would have. I think, if I'm remembering correctly, they had said that often they'd cram sort of 1,000 people into this space. And the only way they could possibly do that really is by people being smushed side by side together with really no room to move around or do anything. Nowadays, of course, because of fire laws and regulations, they don't allow that. But there is still quite a few people. There's not a lot of room to move around. So you really get this sense for how packed that area would be and really why they were the cheap seats. Nowadays, when you go there as well, they don't let you sit down on the ground or anything. So if you are going to go and see a show there, you have to be prepared to stand for about 2.5-3 hours, which doesn't sound like a lot at first until you hit that hour and a half mark, and then you're really wishing you could sit down. But it's just wonderful to go and see a play in this as accurate of a reproduction as they've been able to manage. It turns out that they built it as closely to the specifications of the original globe as possible. In fact, the whole entire thing was built without a nail. It's all built using groove and tongue and also wooden pegs, which makes the whole entire theater. So it's really fascinating to go. If you ever go, please do the museum and the tour beforehand and then go and see a show there, because you really gain a greater appreciation for the space itself and how it was constructed. It's also really interesting that the new old globe was constructed by an American. And many, many, obviously hundreds of years after the original old globe burned down, Sam Worthington decided to come on over from America. He was surprised that there was not even a monument to the original globe that stood in England. His first task was to get a monument posted in one of the pubs that exists around that area now, standing on the grounds near where the old globe stood. And then secondly, later on in his life, it was his project to build this reproduction globe. And it's just fascinating to go there and see performances take place there. As it turns out, they finally did eventually discover the original foundations of the old globe. Again, as I said, about a half a mile away from where the new old globe stands in Bankside. And it was always, again, fascinating to me that it is now the parking lot of an apartment complex that is existent in that area. So just always really interesting to go and see these actual monuments and what's happened to them today after many hundreds of years. In 1599, Richard opened up the globe, as I said, in Bankside after their lease came up in Shoreditch with his father, James, and they took it over to Bankside, and that's where the globe stood, not very far at all from the Swan. They were only, steps away from one another. And then years later, as I said, after the second globe burnt down, there was the Rose, which existed very close to where the new old globe is, but basically right across from where the Swan was. So this was a theater district at the time. There were lots of theaters packed into this space, and there were lots of people going there to see these performances. Let's get back to our question, which I asked at the beginning of the broadcast today, which was, what is some of the differences between the acting style of Shakespeare's time and ours today? And we've had some people type in, so I'm interested in reading some of your responses. And Philip says that Shakespearean theater is different in that it was more representative than modern plays. Also, the language is more old folk English, and tragedies were tragedies. Yes, so definitely tragedies followed a more classic definition of tragedies, having to do with people of higher classes than the average middle class or merchant class person. And it was definitely more presentational. That was one of the defining features. It was much more theatrical, and that was handed down from many ages before and continued on even after Shakespeare's time. But it might surprise you to know that characters didn't speak to one another. They spoke their lines out, and they did it in a very presentational style. In fact, sometimes it was known that actors would simply come out into the stage and find kind of in the shape of a horseshoe, stand, and just deliver their lines. This seems shocking to us, but only because we're such a visual culture today. We are so engaged in the visual aspects and realism, which is, of course, a very recent movement, that sounds very strange to us. But what the Elizabethans were concerned with was not so much these two characters interacting, although there was some of that, but it was more the way they delivered the language. Remember that they were going to hear the play, not to see the play. Which is why, again, if you see some of these sketches of the globe, or if you ever get to the new old globe, that many of these seats are not designed for very good viewing, right? They're not designed so that you can really see the action very well. They're designed so that you can hear it. And that was the key thing that they were there for, was to hear the play, not necessarily to see it. All right, let's look at Anna's comment. Anna says, since copywriting didn't exist in Shakespeare's time, many actors often received their lines right before they went on stage, so other playwrights couldn't steal the play. It's true that they did receive their lines in a very short, what we would consider an extraordinarily short amount of time before their performances. and that what they received was not the entire play as we would get today. You know, if any of you have ever been in a play, you get, you know, the whole entire play, and you read the whole entire play. You read not just your lines, but everybody's lines, right? So that you can get an understanding of how your character fits in and all of this. But, you know, back in Shakespeare's time, you're absolutely right, Anna, there was no copywriting. And so to prevent plagiarism and other things from occurring, actors didn't get the entire text. They got what was called a prompt book, which had only their lines in it and their cue line. So that meaning the line that indicated or was right before their line was about to take place. And to modern actors today, that seems very strange, right? You wouldn't really know what the entire play was about. There might be whole scenes that you weren't in. You wouldn't know about them because you weren't in them until, of course, you got to rehearsal, and then you'd sit and watch what the other actors were doing. But it was a very common practice, and in fact, it was very common all the way through all the way through the Elizabethan time, and then, of course, in later times as well. This was, you know, the way that things were done. It was only recently, when we get into this realism that takes place in the late 19th century, early 20th century, that people start getting the whole play, and then it starts seeming to be important to understand the whole entire text as opposed to just your portion. So that's definitely true. And also, as you said, I believe it was Anna that commented that the actors didn't usually get their lines. You know, now we have 5 to 6 weeks of rehearsal. Actors would often, you know, get their lines maybe 2 weeks, maybe a week before they were about to perform something, and they would be required to memorize all their lines, use that whole week to rehearse, and then they'd put it up, right? So that seems kind of shocking to many of us today that have these 5 or 6 week rehearsal schedules, but that was very standard in that time, so not unusual for actors to be performing with very little rehearsal time beforehand. Let's read Michaela's comment. Michaela says, I have watched a lot of Shakespeare's plays because my mom used to take me to a park close to my house, and we would watch Shakespeare in the Park. Yeah, there are so many places that do that now, and we also have locally Shakespeare by the Sea, which is run by Little Fish in San Pedro, and they take a touring company all over the South Bay, and they do Shakespearean plays, often somewhat abbreviated, and they usually do 2 plays a season, which they alternate depending on where they're going to be at. But there are lots of places where you can see Shakespeare for free nowadays, and it's really wonderful to go out and kind of see them out in the open, which is the way they were intended to be performed, not in a closed theater, right? They were intended to be performed outside, of course, also not intended to be performed at night, but that's a different story. We now have electricity, so we can do that. But it's wonderful to go and see these plays that have come from us, you know, come 400 and some odd years ago, and watch them and appreciate their relevance even today, and their theatrical power is still retained, right? Maddie says, the plays in Shakespeare's time almost always dealt with the monarchy and aristocracy, and the plays nowadays deal with more regular people, not kings and queens. Absolutely. Also very true, right? Almost all of the characters in Shakespeare's plays, at least those of importance or main characters, are often people who are from the aristocracy or people who are of royalty, kings and queens, right? And if we do have people that are from the lower classes, maids and such represented, which we do have those people represented, but they're often there for comedic effect and not necessarily there to have the serious or the best parts, right? They're just there for our entertainment. So definitely a very good comment, Maddie. All right, let's move on and talk a little bit more. We're going to get into some of the actors that existed at the time. Edward Allen was a very well-known actor at the time. Here's a picture of him behind me. He was very bombastic. He was a larger-than-life actor, and he was often given those larger-than-life characters. He often played Faust for the Lord Admiral's Company, and he was a serious actor that had very large, serious parts. Richard Burbage was also a very well-known male actor at the time. He played for the Lord Chamberlain's Men, and that was also the company that Shakespeare ended up working for. He played Richard III. We saw a clip of that, I think, either last week or a couple weeks ago, right? He also was Hamlet, played Lear and Othello. So he was often playing these very serious, dramatic roles. And he was also known for a very interesting acting style that was a little bit more realistic and not as presentational. He was noted for that style of acting, which was very different from what many other people were doing at the time. And he was actually revered for it, but it was very different what he was doing. And although I'm sure if we watched it now, we would still consider it very theatrical and presentational at the time, it was considered a more realistic approach to these parts. One of the playwrights that was a contemporary of Shakespeare's and that existed at the same time as he did, and in fact Shakespeare was accused of murdering him at some point. He was a suspect in his murder, was Christopher Marlowe. Christopher Marlowe was a brilliant playwright. He was worked for the Lord Admiral's men, and he was very notorious. It was rumored that he was a spy and that he was engaged in espionage. It was also rumored that he was a homosexual. He went to jail at some point for homicide. He was murdered at the age of 30, and it was rumored that possibly Shakespeare had poisoned his drink because they were last seen together in this pub right before Christopher Marlowe died. And so it was rumored that possibly Shakespeare had done this. Of course, he was later, the word I'm looking for, I can't think of it right now, but he was later, it was made clear that Shakespeare had nothing to do with it. His plays were very dark. He wrote Faustus, which was, of course, about someone who sells his soul to the devil, and The Tamburling, which is also a very dark play. But he was also a contemporary of Shakespeare and was very well known at the time. Now, Shakespeare, of course, is the premier playwright that comes out at this time period, and we have so many of his plays that have come down through the ages for us through a variety of sources. This is the title page of the first folio, and this is an engraving by Martin Droschaut, and it is considered probably one of the most accurate pictures that we have of him, simply because it was a picture that was, even though it was done posthumously after he died, it was actually approved by his friends that knew him very well, and so, of course, would have known what he looked like. This, of course, is apparently an engraving that was taken later on in his life, or based on him later on in his life. And this is the first page of the folio that was released after Shakespeare had already passed away. Because, of course, while Shakespeare was alive, none of his plays were published. This was a very common practice, at least not officially published. A very common practice because there were no copyright laws. It was a way for these playwrights to maintain custody of their plays and make sure that no other, houses, theatrical houses, were performing them. So it wasn't until after Shakespeare passed away that a couple of his friends and people that worked with him, Condell and I'm forgetting the other person's name, actually put together the first folio, which was a compilation of all of Shakespeare's works over the course of his life. Many of these had never been printed before, but many of them had been printed illegally through what we call the quartos. And this was done usually by actors who had been in the plays and wanted to make a quick buck on the side. They'd go to a printer and they may have their prompt book, but then had also memorized the other parts of the play. And they would dictate these plays to the printer, and then the printer would have them typeset and printed up. And this way they could be distributed. But as you might guess, many of these actors didn't have the most accurate memories. And so there would be a variety of these quartos that existed, some with varying lines and different scenes, and that could be attributed to maybe a lapse in actor's memory, but it could also be attributed to maybe some revisions that took place in the performance that the actor was in, but then maybe later on another actor was in a performance in which scenes had been cut or changed. So during the course of Shakespeare's life, a variety of quartos do exist, which have varying language as well as a variety of scenes. The Scottish play Macbeth is one of those pieces that has some differing quartos out there. Romeo and Juliet, of course, has a wide variety of quartos out there. And most of Shakespeare's plays really have a lot of different versions. If you're an actor and you're looking to perform one of his pieces, or a director looking to direct it, one of your challenges will always be to figure out which version you want to perform. And in fact, in the case of King Lear, there are two versions that are so distinctly different, the version that exists in the folio and then a version that exists in quarto version before that, that oftentimes you will either perform one or the other. Whereas many of these quartos have been kind of compiled and kind of put together in a way that's performable as possibly one piece, King Lear is an example of a play that is absolutely, you're not able to do that. They're so different that you usually either perform the folio version or the quarto version. Well, I'd like to pose another question to you before we finish out with this Shakespeare section, is that what do you think it is that makes Shakespeare's work so unique? And what are some of his techniques that have brought so much attention from audiences over the last 400 years? Right? I mean, these plays have endured over several centuries, and it is something that is really outstanding considering that some of the topics, even though the themes might be universal, the characters are, you know, dated in a way. And many of the pieces deal with historical things that happened many, many hundreds of years ago. The language can be difficult to deal with. And it's not always something that a modern audience is always so receptive to. So what is it that's kept his works around, and what is it that makes them so unique? So again, you can type in your responses at askdhtv@gmail.com, or you can give us a ring at 1-800-339-1193. So I look forward to hearing some of those. Let's talk a little bit more about Shakespeare specifically and some of the things that about his life that are unique and also kind of mysterious. Shakespeare was born in 1564, as far as we know. Keep in mind that there weren't very good birth documents kept at the time, so really his exact date of birth is not really known. We do know the date of his baptism. And we assume that he was baptized relatively, you know, soon after he was born. But we don't know for sure. But we do know he was probably born in 1564 and he died in 1616. You know, his life and his works are something that many students are kind of shy away from, whether it be for study or for performance. And it's very interesting because, again, as I said, I lived in London for a couple of years, and I did, as an American coming over to England, I was very afraid of Shakespeare. And that was me already having my degree in theater and having performed in some Shakespearean plays already. But I just was very afraid of it, and I really felt like, you know, I wasn't going to be an actor who could maybe perform Shakespeare or do it justice. And it's interesting to note that, you know, after living in London for a while and studying there and learning more about Shakespeare and the language, that the English don't have this sort of phobia that we do. I think partly because it's really ingrained in their culture and it's part of their history, and they're just sort of expected, as you know, to know it and understand it. But I think also they approach it in a very different way. I think maybe in America we approach it as something that is so special and wonderful and unique that, you know, and difficult that we will have trouble understanding it. But the fact is that really once you start delving into Shakespeare's language and you have it explained to you appropriately, it's really not as difficult as you might think. And really the stories are stories that are very universal, and they're characters that have tested time. They've gone through time and they've made it over because they are so universal, and they're going through things that people even today can relate to in some way or form. And the language itself, once you gain an appreciation for it, is just so beautiful. You know, it's poetry in motion, and if you get a chance ever to study with someone who can explain it to you properly, I think it's really not that scary. And I hope that today, as we look at some of his works, you'll give yourself a chance to adjust to the sound of his language. If you take some time and are just patient with yourself, it turns out that just like listening to maybe an accent or something that you've never heard before, if you give yourself some time, you can actually adjust your ear to listening to it. And even though you might not understand everything that the actors are saying, you can get a gist. And if you take some more time outside of class and you actually sit and start trying to read some of the plays with either a Shakespeare dictionary with you or maybe someone who understands the text a little bit better, you'll find that there is really, it's really not that difficult to understand. You know, nowadays they have this No Fear Shakespeare that's out there and you can kind of read the original document next to a modern translation, and that's also very helpful. But there's really a lot to gain from reading his plays and having an understanding from them, because we have so much of our, you know, our current dramaturgical history is taken from Shakespeare, and he's one of our greatest playwrights in the West. So I think it is worthwhile to study him, even for a little while, even if you find it difficult. Well, Shakespeare is quite a mystery, and there are a lot of things that we don't know about him. As I said before, we don't know exactly when he was born. In fact, we're not even completely sure as to what he exactly looked like. We think that the Chandos portrait is probably one of our more accurate portraits of him. This is the one that hangs in the National Gallery and was one of the National Gallery's first acquisitions. We also think the engraving that exists in the folio that you saw a moment ago is also one of the more accurate pictures of Shakespeare. So we think we kind of know what he looks like, although there are a wide variety of portraits that exist out there that show him looking quite different from this, so it's really hard to know. But it is said that Shakespeare had a very charming personality. He was reported to be very handsome. I mean, he must have been. He allegedly had a wide variety of affairs with married and unmarried women. He had a smooth wit. He was good-natured and was often called Goodwill. So he was a guy that you wanted to be around. He was very upbeat, cheerful, positive personality. He, as I said before, was, we believe, born in 1564, we believe on April 22nd, to John Smithfield and Mary Arden. He was the oldest of five siblings, and his father was a very well-known glover, and his mother was came from a very wealthy landowner. So here you can see this picture of him behind me that kind of looks very different in some ways to some of the other photos you see, but this is obviously a young Shakespeare, and you can see how he could be interpreted as quite a handsome bloke for the Elizabethan time. His father actually eventually rose to be mayor, but the family suffered many reversals and poor fortune, and eventually ended up solidly kind of in the middle class. His boyhood was filled with games and awareness of the countryside, of course, maypole dances and visiting bear baiting. For those of you that might not know what bear baiting is, it was basically a bunch of people that would go out to see a bear be baited and teased around a ring, kind of like bullfighting today in the more modern Hispanic countries. And people would often make bets as to how long the bear would last. There was, of course, hunting that was quite common at the time, fairs and dramas that people would go and see, whether it be locally or in other places. And these all gave Shakespeare a wide taste of the English countryside and an experience with lots of different characters, which of course he drew upon later in his life as he was writing a wide variety of these characters, and a portrait of the lively sort of Elizabethan life that existed at the time. He was educated in a middle school that was run locally, and he most likely would have been educated in Latin, in the grammar there. But he didn't have any college education like the other aristocrats that were writing plays at the time, like Christopher Marlowe, who came from an aristocratic family. You know, Shakespeare came from a very solidly middle-class family, a merchant class. And so it's often been, the question has been posed, how could he possibly had such a facility for language? How could he have possibly written these amazing plays with, you know, this wonderful verbiage that he uses in his pieces? Well, there is a rumor that he may have served as a teacher at some point before his stint in the theater really took off. And maybe this is where he gained that deep knowledge of the English language and his facility for it. There's really no way to know. No, there's about 15 years of Shakespeare's life right after he gets married to Anne Hathaway in 1983, where we kind of just don't know what happens to him. He kind of drops off of the face of the earth. And because, again, you know, we didn't have all the technologies that we have now. The only thing we could count on was paper documents. Unless he was getting into trouble, there was really no way to know what happened. He wasn't famous at the time. So aside from legal documents, we don't really know what happened to him. But again, there has been some rumor that perhaps he served as a teacher at the time. As I said before, he did marry Anne Hathaway November 27th, 1583. It was a shotgun wedding. He was married very quickly, and 6 months later, Anne Hathaway gave birth to their first child. I believe her name is Samantha. And then sometime later, very shortly after that, she also gives birth to a set of twins, I believe Juliana and Hamnet. Hamnet dies at the age of 11 for unknown reasons. And shortly after that is when William Shakespeare leaves the family for an unknown reason and goes to London. Thankfully for us, he does, because this is where he gets his claim to fame and he begins writing for the theater and becomes very successful. Somewhere around 1588, we get this upstart of Shakespeare coming around, and we get him making his scene on, we may get him making his way onto the theater scene. We get a lot of theaters taking a bunch of different plays, and these groups or troops of actors kind of forming together around playwrights and performing these pieces. This is a wonderful aerial of London. I actually like to go to a full screen of this, and we can kind of look at some of the things that were apparent during the time. Here you can see, this is the Thames right here. This is the Thames right here. And let's see if that's gonna come through for me. There we go. And this is the bridge that went across. If you go to London today, the Thames is much smaller and much deeper. At the time, the Thames was much shallower and much wider, and you can see that the bridge that stretches across is very big. Over here is London proper. Over here is Bankside. And this is where all of the theaters existed. So in order to go to the theater, you had to leave London proper, go across the bridge. On this bridge were lots of merchants and people selling things, vendors and food vendors and clothing vendors and all sorts of things. And you go to the other side, and this is where all the fun existed. This is where all the brothels were, and where all the theaters were, and the bear baiting rings, and a wide variety of fun things existed over there. But all of the major theaters existed over there, as well as the theater troops, the Lord Pembroke's men, the Lord Chamberlain's men, later the King's men, and all of these theater troops were associated with specific theaters and often had dedicated playwrights writing for them. Shakespeare's early plays were big crowd pleasers. This is what got him his big audiences. They were, you know, violent action stories like Titus Andronicus, or farcical comedies like the Comedy of Errors, which was based on also an original Roman myth, and which Shakespeare did quite a lot. Actually, if you start researching Shakespeare, one of the things that you will notice about many of his earlier pieces, not so much his later pieces like Othello and Hamlet, but his earlier pieces were based on a lot of existent stories that came from Roman and Greek either plays and or myths. And he just sort of rewrote them to be relevant and to take place in different times and different places with different characters. And they were big crowd pleasers. People loved to come and see his plays, and he turned out big houses, which of course made lots of money for the theater owner, as well as the troupe of actors that were working for him. In 1592 to 1594, the plague did hit, the Black Plague, and many, many theaters closed, and people started evacuating the main city centers because they believed that it was over a wide variety of things. They didn't really know what was causing the plague or how it was passing around, but one of the theories was that it was foul smells that were existent in the city. These were places that were very unsanitary. You know, there was no central plumbing. People would throw their excrement outside of their windows onto the dirt pathways. You know, animals that were being, livestock that was being taken through these areas would, you know, foul the main walkways. And this water would run off into the Thames, which people would take for drinking water as well as bathing water. So you can imagine how the unsanitary conditions made it very easy for something like this to spread around. So a lot of the aristocracy, especially and anyone that had money, fled from the inner workings of the city and went to the countryside hoping to survive this devastation. You know, this is a disease, not a disease, but this is a virus that killed a third of the European population. People were dying en masse, and there was really, they really couldn't do anything about it, and it was a very difficult time. Shakespeare didn't leave, although many of the other theater companies did. They went on tour and went around the countryside trying to live, but his did not. He did not, and he stayed, and he wrote all the sonnets. The wonderful sonnets that we have from Shakespeare were written during this time, and he gained a literary reputation as not just being a kind of popular playwright, but being someone who had real literary chops. And once the Pembroke's men disbanded, he joined the Lord Chamberlain's men, and he becomes even more popular. But not just that, he becomes critically acclaimed. And he sort of took a clue from Marlowe, who had used a lot of English history to inspire his plays. And he also develops this idea, and he writes a wide variety of histories, one of which we saw, but Henry VI, Richard II, Richard III, and Henry V. And these become very, very popular. Romeo and Juliet as well, he writes during this time. And this is, of course, probably one of the most popular Elizabethan plays during that time and possibly of all time. I'm sure all of us have seen some version of Romeo and Juliet, whether it be the Claire Danes Leonardo DiCaprio version or whether it be a later version or whether you saw it at your high school, you read it at your high school. It's a play for the ages, and it has lasted through much, much time. Well, we're going to take a quick break here, and when we come back, we're going to watch some clips from Shakespeare and a wide variety of his plays, and we'll read some of these wonderful comments that you've written in about this. So I'll see you in about 5 minutes. I'm sure that, there we go.
Television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
My name is Travis Shannon, and I decided to come to Cal State Dominguez Hills to the Digital Media Arts program because of the small class sizes, personal one-on-one attention I receive from instructors, as well as the freedom that I have to create the projects that I want to.
California State University Dominguez Hills Orthotic and Prosthetic Program is unique among the 11 accredited programs in the United States. Cal State program emphasizes heavily clinical input. All the schools are kind of shifting towards a theory-based practice, where the school here is showing that theory base and showing the clinical applications, but we do it in a manner on patient models. We have 15 projects in prosthetics and 16 projects in orthotics with actual live patient models, which is either double or triple some of the other schools out there. So we do a lot more hands-on, a lot more fabrication end of it. So not only learning why we're making the devices, but we also learn how we're making the devices. So keep that technical input into the program. So that really makes our program unique amongst the other schools. For students looking to get into this field and find out a little bit more about prosthetics and orthotics, there's a few different resources for them. The National Commission of Orthotic and Prosthetic Education, ncope.org, has a great website to get some more information on. And we do have a specific website for careers in orthotics and prosthetics that goes through how you become a practitioner, how you can implement your skills, and then learn about the various schools and what they offer. And that's opcareers.org. So opcareers.org. It's a great website to get more information on that. Our site, calstatedominguezhills.edu.
This is my university.
Hey, Mark, nice paper.
This is student life.
I'm home right now, but...
Sweet!
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, and welcome back to Theater 100, Television, Film, and Theater. I'm Naomi Buckley. And let's continue on with our broadcast today. I want to start by reading some of your comments, and we'll move on to looking at some clips of some Shakespearean plays. I want to remind you that we are live and online. You can give us a ring at 1-800-339-1193, or you can send us a comment or question at askdhtv@gmail.com. All right. Well, David is saying, in response to what makes Shakespeare so unique and what has allowed him to stand the test of time, is that part of the reason that Shakespeare is often so difficult to understand is that if he didn't have an adequate verb to describe something, he simply made up a word or expression up off the top of his head. Absolutely. In fact, many of the words and expressions that we have today come from Shakespeare. So there are a lot of things that we've taken from him that have entered into the common language that didn't exist before him. So be forewarned, that's a phrase that comes from Shakespeare. And there are a wide variety of others that come from him as well as just well-known phrases that you would recognize that you might not use in your everyday language, like to be or not to be, or a rose by any other name would smell as sweet, right? All right, Jocelyn says, Shakespeare's plays resonate across time because they speak to universal themes of indecision, tragic circumstances, greed, love, fear, and there are always consequences for his behaviors and for these behaviors in his play. Right, wonderful. Yes, his themes are so universal, and he had such a wonderful way of having insight into human nature and writing about that. And I think that that's, in addition to how he wrote his plays, is why they have stood the test of time. Sydney Marielle says, Shakespeare's works are unique because the themes he writes about are everlasting. For instance, themes of love and deception are relatable. His themes are recognizable to modern audiences. Absolutely. You know, as you said, Sydney, and as the person before said, themes of greed, of love, of jealousy, all of these things are things that are kind of part of human nature, and we can relate to them whether it be 400 years ago or whether it be today, 2013, right? So he was wonderful at writing plays that kind of captured that nature, that the essence of human nature, and then relating it in this really beautiful, poetic way, right? All right. Well, we've talked a lot about Shakespeare. We've heard a lot about the time period and what he did in his life. What I'd like to do now is take a look at some clips from his plays. And we're going to start with Julius Caesar. This is, again, maybe one that you read in high school. I know it was the one I had to read in high school. And this, of course, is taken from some Roman history. And it's where we get the famous line, E tu, Brute, right? So let's take a look at Julius Caesar by Shakespeare.
What is now amiss that Caesar and his Senate must redress?
Most high, most mighty, and most puissant Caesar, Metellus Cimber throws before thy seat an humble heart.
I must prevent thee, Cimber. These couchings and these lowly courtesies might fire the blood of ordinary men and turn pre-ordinance and first decree into the law of children. Be not fond to think that Caesar bears such rebel blood that will be thawed from the true quality with that which melteth fools. I mean, sweet words, low crooked curtsies, and base spaniel fawning. But thy brother by decree is banished. If thou dost bend and pray and fawn for him, I spurn thee like a cur out of thy way. No, Caesar doth not wrong, nor without cause will he be satisfied.
Is there no voice more worthy than my own, to sound more sweetly in great Caesar's ear for the repealing of my banished brother?
I kiss thy hand, but not in flattery, Caesar. Desiring thee that Publius Cimber may have an immediate freedom of repeal.
What, Brutus?
Pardon, Caesar, Caesar, pardon! As low as to thy foot doth Cassius fall to beg in franchisement for Publius Cimber.
I could be well moved if I were as you. If I could pray to move, then prayers would move me. But I am constant as the northern star, of whose true fixed and resting quality there is no fellow in the firmament. The skies are painted with unnumbered sparks, they are all fire, and every one doth shine, but there's but one in all doth hold his place. So in the world, 'tis furnished well with men, and men are flesh and blood and apprehensive. Yet I do know but one in the number that unassailable holds on his rank, unshaped of motion. And that I am he, let me a little show it even in this, that I was constant. Cimber should be banished, and constant do remain, do keep him so.
Oh, Caesar!
Hence wilt thou lift up Olympus!
Great Caesar!
Doth not Brutus bootless kneel?
Speak hands for me.
So, I'm sure we all are familiar with that line, E tu, Brute, and a wonderful scene. One of the things that makes Shakespeare's work so unique is his ability to write these kinds of scenes with this sort of epic grandeur and nobility that seems appropriate to the characters that are involved, right? The language itself elevates it to that level, and he does an amazing job of creating those moments. Yeah, one of the other things that he's so well known for is his humor. And as a comment here that I will read in a moment after this clip, his ability to use rhetoric and As You Like It is one of the his more well-known plays that includes both of these things, comedy, romance, and a wonderful rhetorical tongue. So let's watch a little clip from As You Like It.
We are not all alone unhappy. This wide and universal theater presents more woeful pageants than the scene wherein we play in.
All the world's a stage. And all the men and women merely players. They have their exits and their entrances. And one man in his time plays many parts, his acts being seven ages. At first, the infant, kneeling and puking in the nurse's arms. Then the whining schoolboy with his satchel and shining morning face, creeping like snail unwillingly to school. And then the lover, sighing like furnace, with a woeful ballad made to his mistress' eyebrow. Then a soldier, full of strange oaths and bearded like the pard, jealous in honor, sudden and quick in quarrel, seeking the bubble reputation even in the cannon's mouth. And then the justice, in fair round belly, with good capon lined, with eyes severe and beard of formal cut, full of wise saws and modern instances. And so he plays his part. The sixth age shifts into the lean and slippered pantaloon. With spectacles on nose and pouch on side. His youthful hose well saved. The world too wide for his shrunk shank. And his big manly voice turning again toward childish treble, pipes and whistles in his son. Last scene of all that ends this strange, eventful history. His second childishness and mere oblivion. Sans teeth, sans eyes, sans taste, sans everything.
It's a wonderful monologue. And of course, a very famous line, right? All the world's a stage and all the men and women are players. Another line that we get from Shakespeare. I'm going to read Philip's comment and then we'll watch a couple more clips before we move on to talking about playwriting in the last little bit of time that we have. Philip says, Shakespeare utilized poetry verse in eloquent and elaborate soliloquies, which are sometimes rhetorical. His plays are often very, very dramatic. Yes. Yeah. So we saw an example of that, right? That wasn't a soliloquy, that was a monologue because other people were there listening. But, you know, Shakespeare used the monologue, he used soliloquy, he used a wide variety of things. He's, you know, very well known for iambic pentameter and his use of verse and blank verse and language. And all of those things which make his plays very unique. We talked a moment ago about King Lear and how there are kind of really two distinctive versions that exist, one in the folio and one as a quarto version. Well, let's watch a little clip of King Lear now. One moment as they cue it up. They're queuing that.
Oh, these eclipses do portend these divisions.
Hello, Brother Edmund. Mm-hmm.
What serious contemplation are you in?
I'm thinking, Brother, of a prediction I read this other day. What should follow these eclipses?
Do you busy yourself with that?
I promise you, the effects he writes of succeed unhappily. It is of unnaturalness between the child and the parent. Death, dearth, dissolutions of ancient amities, divisions in state, menaces and maledictions against king and nobles, needless diffidences, banishment of friends, dissipation of cohorts, nuptial breaches, and I know not what.
How long have you been a sectary astronomical?
Come, come.
When saw you my father last?
A night gone by.
Spake you with him?
Aye, 2 hours together.
Parted you in good terms? Found you no displeasure in him by word nor countenance?
None at all.
Bethink yourself wherein you may have offended him, and that my entreaty forbear his presence until some little time hath qualified the heat of his displeasure, which at this instant so rageth in him that with the mischief of your person it would scarcely allay.
Some villain hath done me wrong.
That's my fear. I pray you have a continent forbearance till the speed of his rage goes slower. And as I say, retire with me to my lodging, from whence I will quickly bring you to hear my lord speak. Pray ye go. There's my key. If you do stir abroad, go armed.
Armed, brother?
Brother, I advise you to the best. I am no honest man if there be any good meaning toward you. I have told you what I have seen and heard, but faintly, nothing like the image and the horror of it. Pray you away.
Shall I hear from you alone?
I do serve you in this business. Credulous father, and a brother noble whose nature is so far from doing harms that he suspects none, on whose foolish honesty my practices ride easy. I see the business. Let me, if not by birth, have lands by wit. All with me's meat that I can fashion fit.
So there we had at the end of that an example of the soliloquy, right? Where we get taken into the thoughts of the character that's speaking. And it was interesting the way they used the camera to kind of break the fourth wall and take us into that. Well, I think we spent a lot of time talking about Shakespeare today and Elizabethan theater. I mean, of course, we could spend the next rest of the session and another one talking about it. But I want to move on and use the last little bit of time we have here to talk about playwriting. Remember that this is, I think I misquoted the chapters maybe at the beginning. Yes, this is actually chapters 13 and 15 in your newest edition of the Wilson text. I want to talk a little bit about narrative writing versus dramatic writing. And Aristotle said all plays must be written in a dramatic, not a narrative form. What's the difference between that? Well, a play is not about talking about the past or talking about what happened, right? That's narration. A play is about showing what happened. And so therefore it must take place in the present. We must see the doing happening. We might look back or have a flashback to something that happened in the past, but the play needs to be about what is actually happening, not about a telling, right? And narration is about telling. Nowadays in maybe films, you might see that as a voiceover. And sometimes when you have monologues, those have some narrative qualities to them. But it is important that a play be about doing, and that's what it's still about. It is important that we have a play be about doing. Well, playwrights are the people that write the plays. They create the architecture of the play. And they are interested in the dramatic structure while writing. And that is a wide variety of things that happen throughout a plot, right? And a plot is not necessarily the story. Again, it's not just talking about what happens. It's that the story itself must have these really important plot points that the playwright wants to hit. One of those things is exposition that happens in the opening scene usually, or in some of the opening scenes. Of course, exposition can take place anytime in the play, but it most often happens in the beginning, and it tells us about things that happened before the play began. The play began in the time of the status quo, the time before we started watching. Then we get also another moment where we get the inciting incident, right? This is the moment when something happens that changes the world of the people that are inside of the play. This is going to create the thrust of the dramatic action throughout the rest of the piece. And through the inciting incident, we get the action of the play. And this comes in the rising action, right? This is where we have reversals happen, conflict, and a variety of other scenes that take us to the highest moment of tension in the play, which is the climax. And this is where the conflict of the play gets resolved. It's also where the major dramatic question gets finally answered, the thing that the audience has been asking the whole entire time. For instance, in The Lion King is a play I like to use a lot because the plot is very similar to Hamlet. And the question in The Lion King is, will Simba ever return home and take his rightful place as king, right? And in that final moment, the climax of the film, where we see Simba and Scar duke it out and Scar finally dies, we get our question answered for us. And the question is, the answer is, of course, yes. So the highest moment of tension that takes place in a play or a film is called the climax. After that, we have falling action, which kind of is a wrapping up of ends, right? We get to see how maybe some loose ends have been tied up. Here's a wonderful diagram. You can see the kind of climactic diagram here for a plot. We get this falling action that takes us down, and then, and also, it's also called denouement. We get that final bit of the play or the movie in which we kind of see this, these final moments, and we know that everyone's, you know, going to live happily ever after, or everything's going to be okay, or everything's different now. That's the most important thing, right? Things might not be okay. They might not ever return to what they were, but they will be different and hopefully better, sometimes not, right? So that's the classic climactic structure that most playwrights follow when they're writing. And this is, of course, also following a very linear progression through these points, which is not necessarily how modern plays are written today. We have things that take apart that linear structure. But still, these plot points must be hit in this way. We expect that from our entertainment, our plays, our stories, film and cinema and television, all of them follow the same kind of structure. And in fact, when they don't, we often get a feeling that something's wrong or it's difficult for us to get into the story because we have this structure so ingrained in us. One of the things that is important also about playwriting is that we establish a protagonist and an antagonist. And this can kind of be thought of as the good guy and the bad guy. But a more accurate definition would be someone, the protagonist is always the person to whom the most change occurs for, right? When we start out the play and then we get to the end, we look at the character for whom the most change has occurred. That might be internally, that might be externally, but it is almost always the person for whom the most change has occurred. The antagonist is usually either the person or the things that are keeping the protagonist from sort of achieving whatever it is that their goal is in the piece. If we look at back at The Matrix, and The Matrix trilogy is another one I like to use because a lot of people have seen it. It has a very classic kind of plot structure. Mr. Smith, the agent Mr. Smith, is the main antagonist. Now, of course, there are a lot of things that are antagonistic in that plot, but Mr. Smith is the main antagonist. He keeps the character, Keanu Reeves' character Neo, from achieving his ultimate goal. And at the end, when we have that final climactic moment, that is the character with whom Neo has to face off with, Mr. Smith. So a plot is an arrangement of scenes that hit certain points. And what makes a plot different from just a storyline or a story is a causality, right? One thing that happens in this scene causes the next thing to happen, right? And they all kind of progress logically from one thing to the next. We see how they are connected and we see how the cause and effect works. And this is an important thing for playwrights and screenwriters to adhere to because it makes sense of the action for the audience. And for instance, in Romeo and Juliet, when Romeo gets banished, it's specifically because he kills Tybalt, right? So one event is, the one plot sequence is building off of something that happened in a previous scene, and they're all connected in that way. One of the other things that a playwright is thinking about is, of course, the dialogue. What kind of language are these characters using, and how will it speak about their character, and how will it be relatable to the audience? Shakespeare was thinking about that in his time. All the people that were of aristocracy spoke in strict iambic pentameter and often in rhyming verse, and those people that were lower down didn't speak in rhyming verse. So even he was thinking about it then, and we think about that now, and dialogue and the way characters speak says a lot about who they are, and playwrights are, of course, thinking about that as well. There, of course, are a variety of complications that will take place through the course of a play or a film, and these are outside forces that work their way on the protagonist, or new twists in the plot that the playwright decides to introduce to create more tension in the play. An example is in Romeo and Juliet, when Juliet's father wants her to marry Paris, right? And then this forces her to fake her death so that she doesn't have to marry Paris, and that, of course, takes us to the tragic end of that play. And that's a plot twist that occurs, a complication that kind of furthers the plot along and brings us to the tragic ending of Romeo and Juliet. We talked a moment ago about the climax, but this is the final and most significant crisis of the play, where the conflict of the play is finally resolved, and again, also where the major dramatic question is resolved. And for instance, if we go back to Raisin in the Sun, this is the moment of Mama versus Walter, where he finally reveals that he's lost all the money, and Mama, reacts, and he reacts, and we have this great moment where that crisis, the thing we've been building to kind of all throughout the play, is resolved. And she finds out, and we find out what she's going to do, and we find out what's going to happen. It's kind of the question we've been asking the whole entire time, right? And that's the climax of that piece. The playwright, of course, is always thinking about the different kinds of characters that he or she will need to people his play with. From, who will be the hero to also who will be the foil for the hero. That's usually a character that the hero plays off of to kind of usually make the hero bring out the qualities of the hero that the playwright wants, right? So if the hero is supposed to appear really smart, then we want the foil to be really dumb. You know, if the hero is maybe supposed to be really handsome, then maybe we want the foil to be someone who's really ugly. So the playwright is thinking of these things in ways that kind of bring out the themes and as well as the overall plot to the audience. And as he's doing this, he's thinking, or she might be thinking, about their appearance, what kind of speech patterns they have, the action that they're going to do, and what others say about them. They also want to make the main character empathetic, right? We want the audience to empathize with them, to relate to them, because otherwise we don't have audience buy-in to the story. And we want them to be people that we care about, so that we care about what's happening in the story. We get invested in the plot, and that gives us that sense of cathartic release at the end when things often work out well for the protagonist. You know that a character is a protagonist when most of the time, for most things, you're looking at them going, okay, that character is not going to die. No matter what, I think that character is probably not going to die. And that's because we sense sort of intuitively that they're the main character and that things are kind of revolving around them. And they're the one that's going to kind of teach us this final moral lesson that the playwright is hoping to give us. So we've talked about a lot today, haven't we? We spent a lot of time talking about Shakespeare, Elizabethan theater. I hope you enjoyed that and watching some clips from some Shakespearean plays. We spent some time talking about playwriting. I know we didn't cover everything, so please go back to chapter 13 and 15 to review that. We are going to be on spring break for the next week, so it'll be a little bit of time before I see you again. I hope you have a wonderful spring break, and I'll see you back here in that second week of April when we come back. Have a wonderful spring break, and I'll see you later.